or recollecting whatever I did today 5 years later. 5 years later, will I be happy to think that on this date, I did this thing? So that should be the decision making thought that should come into every one of your minds so that you can protect yourself. Because life is really, really, it is a gift and that has been given to us only once. So we are here to enjoy health. So it is just not physical health, it is also emotional health, it is also social health, and also keeping away from certain habits which is going to make a big difference in your future career development, as well as you're going to feel proud that I have come out of this place, though I knew there has been plenty of influences to get distracted, but still I came out without getting distracted. So that shows your strength. So wish you all the best. Have fun.
Last presenter is a very great designation. So we decided there'll be no PowerPoint presentations, no videos, no clips. The bad news is I can actually see you sleeping. You know? Gentlemen here. So wake up, one more thing, then you can go back home. So one thing which a lot of people when they come to Chennai first time is always, when you ask them like, what is the one thing which is always worrying you, really you're afraid of, they always say, auto. Very afraid of the auto. Auto is big problem. So, when you walk into an auto, I'm going to share a little secret. After which, you will not be afraid of the Chennai auto wala anymore. If you get into any auto in Chennai, usually you'll see this little thing called. If you can zoom in on this, bodyguard Munishwarar Thunai. You walk into any auto anywhere in Chennai, you will see this sentence right on top. So I was also quite curious. So I have this auto Raman who is my local neighborhood auto wala. I said, what is this bodyguard Munishwarar? He said, like, sir, it's a secret. Don't tell anybody. There's a small Munishwarar, very small temple on the way to Central Station. Okay, all the auto walas, as soon as they get their registration in RTO, you will see long row of autos and trucks right next to Central Station. And they go and put this little thing on their auto. And just like Superman, when he goes to a planet and gets superhuman powers. So that is how your auto man, once he puts this on, you know, the auto man becomes Superman. And then lorry, truck, bus, metro, whatever comes, he can fly through Chennai. Okay? So that's a little secret. So basically, since the topic of the day was accepting differences, that's why I thought like maybe I'll dress up in a t-shirt and a lungi and a dhoti and see whether TED will accept. You know, somebody, you are supposed to dress very formal to be in TED. So, incidentally, like eFarm, this is a company which we found. We work with farmers, we work with truck drivers, we work with sabjiwalas. There's a Coimbatore, a big sabji mandi right next door. If you go there, this is the formal dress they wear. You know, a banyan and a lungi. Okay, so I am dressed formal with respect to my industry. So that is what I want to project today. And today I'm not going to bore you about the marketing side of eFarm, what eFarm is. Interestingly, what I want to talk today in TED is the making of eFarm. Typically in a Jackie Chan movie, we really see at the end of the movie, you'll always see this making of that movie where he falls from the top and breaks his legs and all that. So we got to share some secrets about behind the scenes of eFarm. Why did we start this company? Why this company? So to start with, first of all, one common question everybody asks is like, you were in the IIT. So thanks to the introducer, he said, you were in IIT Kharagpur, you did this, you went abroad, you worked for the IT industry for 12 years. Why did you start a farming company or agri company after coming back to India? Okay. In Vivek comedy, they usually say, sir, eppadi irundha neenga ippadi aayitingale sir. So the truth of the story is boredom. We were just bored. You know, initially, I know that a lot of you might have got job offers from leading IT companies and very proud to join. But you know, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, when you become project managers, account managers, then you are just managing 10,000 people, 15,000 people, and every day is just a people management problem. So you'll get an email saying, go find 5,000 Java developers tomorrow. And you're just running around every campus trying to find whoever is trespassers will be recruited. That's typically the thing which you usually have. So after a point, we just got bored. He said, this is not what I wanted to do in life. This is not what I went to IIT for. He came back to India. And second thing about IITians is one thing which always attracted to IIT was the problem solving. You'll always find IITians sitting in a corner always solving problems, you know, like equation to pi and stuff like that. We are not very socially active people. So people call me as a social, you know, a social entrepreneur. I'm not at all social. Let me tell you, don't even try making friends with me. But the thing is, when we came back, we thought like, you know, things like agriculture. Every time when you read up the paper, there was always problems about farmer, this thing, this thing. We thought like this problem was what really attracted us. So if nobody is able to solve this problem, why don't we get in and try and, you know, solve this problem, okay? So interestingly, some people laughed at us. Some people said like, no, you're doing something crazy. But the thing is like, what I wanted to share is, for example, there are people like firefighters. Everybody, if there's a fire in this building, do you think your dean is going to sit here and try to save it? They'll all be running away. But there are people who are running into this building, trying to save all these things. So what makes them tick? What is the drive of these people who are walking into a crisis? The whole thing is like they have this passion. Like, for example, we had Mr. Venkat who said, emergency, you know, extremely complicated things. Every day people are dying. But there are people who actually want to do that. You know, that there's some kick in saving a life. There's a kick in solving a crisis. So that's what really drove us to start a company like this, because if the problem is not there, then we won't be standing here today. Okay. The second thing is when we started getting into this problem, but then we realized that not many people really had a good understanding, because very few people were in the agri industry and nobody wanted to be in this industry. Everybody was running away. The banks were running away. Farmers, their own sons were running away. They themselves said their kids, like I'm pretty sure a lot of students here must be farmers' sons and daughters. They themselves sell their land and make sure don't stay in this village, go away. Okay, that was the situation. So what? When we went back, we sat in a lot of conferences, we sat in a lot of universities, but one thing which kind of, we realized that a lot of the information which was there was very theoretical. Like there were professors who came and had a whole conference on tomato, lycopene production and all that. But if you ask his wife, does he know how to go and buy tomato? He's like, no way. He doesn't know, don't send him to the market to buy tomato. He doesn't know ABCD of tomato. He can do conferences. But practically, there are a lot of things that you need to know before you can actually get into things. So we actually spend a lot of time sitting in the fields, asking the farmers, what are their problems? Interestingly, they don't want money. A lot of people think, like even yesterday, the finance minister said, more debts, more loans to the farmer. Actually, farmers don't want money. What they want is marketing support. Day in and day out, every day, because most of the time, the farmers are too busy, they don't even come to any conferences. If you go to the field and ask him, what is the number one problem for you? They say, help me sell the product. Because selling a product, especially a perishable product, like vegetables and farm produce, is extremely difficult. You can't expect a farmer to just run around and go around everywhere and try to sell. That is their number one problem. Second is labor. They don't have anybody to even harvest. So most of the time they do this harvest. Like yesterday there was a news that, you know, Bihar has had a fantastic record production of potatoes. Second question is, who's going to harvest them? So just wait, another week they're going to come back and say, oh, all the prices of potato and beer has fallen down. Because there's nobody going to harvest them. And who's going to eat all the potatoes? It has to come down somewhere else. So the whole supply chain is where we saw the biggest problem is. So then we spend a lot of time with the truck drivers. Why is it a problem for them? Most of the time the trucks, the organized players are not in this industry at all. So usually you'll only find the sardars and the local guys running the trucks. So when they run, they're not organized. They also have middlemen and people working with them. So they run from one place to another. So that's why you'll see usually, if you just drive along Vadapalani this side, you'll see a lot of trucks just parked waiting for business, because they don't know where the return business is going to come. So sometimes 2 days, 3 days, they're just waiting. So one day they'll go from Madurai to Coimbatore, next day from Coimbatore to Bihar, then from Bihar to Nasik, from Nasik to Rishikesh, and all over India. So typically a trucker's life is also extremely chaotic. That is why you'll see a very strange correlation between AIDS and truck drivers. Why are they promoting condoms to truck drivers? This is the reason. And if you really sit with the truck driver and say, if I have a simple way by which I can go from my hometown is Chennai, I go to Madurai and come back to Chennai, I don't need to do this. And I can do it cheaper. And I can, because most of the time the return journey, they have to do it empty. So they have to double charge the farmer. So that is why the transport costs are also pretty high. So then we came to the city. Interestingly, the sabjiwala, like, you know, the person who actually goes to the Coimbatore market every day at 3 o'clock, comes back and sits in near your house and sells the vegetable. Their lifestyle, most people don't know. Everybody thinks they are making a lot of money, but actually, interestingly, there was Chellamma, who was right next to my to her house, for 40-50 years, right from my grandmother's day, right when since I was a kid, she has been delivering vegetables, fruits, and everything. And she was really the person who literally, you know, brought me up, because all the food I ate was because she was going to the Coimbatore market every day and getting this stuff back. So we used to spend a lot of time with her, the sabji walas, the dabba walas, trying to understand how the underbelly of India really works. And that is how we made the model. So the eFarm model, if you really truly say, we can't have a patent on it, because hundreds of people like Chellammas and Munusamis and Mayandis have actually contributed to what we are today. So it is a very, very ground up, grassroots kind of thing. So when we went to the banks or the universities or investors with this model, they all laughed at it, because this is very unconventional. There is no need for, because they are all saying cold storages and things like that, which are very Western concept. Whereas we were talking about just-in-time delivery, like what the Dabbawalas were doing. A world-class delivery system organized by 5,000 uneducated people. They are delivering lunch tiffin boxes every single day, 2 lakh dabbas, with not one dabba missed for over 120 years. And that is the most fantastic distribution mechanism you ever need. Better than the Dells, better than the Walmarts of the world. Why are we not taking that and adapting it to the Indian industry? The thing is, sometimes as Indians, we don't respect our own technologies or our own importance or what we have learned. Okay. Another thing, very classically people say, oh, we have to go to Israel to learn something. We have to go to America to learn about them. America was discovered by mistake. If you look at your history lessons, Columbus was supposed to come to Trivandrum, you know, to Kerala, to buy our cardamom and spices. He missed completely and went West Indies. That's why they are called West Indians, and we are East Indians. Okay, that whole country would not have been discovered, and we were doing agriculture for 5,000 years. You've read Mohenjo-Daro civilization, Harappa civilization. We were doing agriculture when their ancestors were, you know, running in trees. Okay, so why are we going to the Americans and Europeans and trying to learn agriculture from them? Our forefathers were doing organic for 10,000 years. And suddenly there's a big fad, organic, okay. Plus before 40 years, everything was organic. Where were the fertilizers? Who brought the fertilizers into India? It was the Western countries which introduced fertilizer into India. So our own traditions we have forgotten. Okay, so that is why we said, okay, let's stay away from the conventional thought process, and we picked up a model. Once we decided the model, we started doing it. We do the pilots and all that. It was quite interesting. Chennai was literally our test ground. We started in a car, of boot car. We used to sell in the beach side. If some of you have done walking on the beach side, would have seen us. Then we sold on the street side. Then we got a little funds. Then we started our own operation. That's how we grew. Another interesting problem we got stumped was people. Okay, the idea is great, fantastic. Who would want to join an agri company? Not any of you, right? Because who actually joins the agriculture department in any college? Be frank. You get 2,000 ranks, 3,000 ranks into your GATE exam or any of your exams. The toppers always want to join computer science, mechanical, civil, whatever. After 2,000 ranks are over, the bottommost last 20 says, which department is left? Agriculture department. Let me take that. Have you ever had a topper of any engineering college ever saying, I want to become a farmer or I want to join the agriculture industry? Even people who are in the TNAU agriculture campus, the entire batch, 400 people, do you know where they join? Banks. All your loan officers are all agriculture graduates or BSc graduates, because they all want an easy life. Nobody wants to go back to a tough industry where it is very challenging, because there are no successful agriculture companies. And frankly speaking, agriculture is not even treated like an industry anymore. If you look at the economic budget, it's only an expense. So many crores, just give it to them, forget about it. It is not even seen as something which is supposed to give you back even principle. So how do you work in such an environment? So interestingly, a lot of students applied as interns because they wanted to at least get an experience of this, or at least like a startup experience is always good in your resume. So at least like later on you can get a job. It doesn't matter. So we used that little ploy. So we had a lot of free labor, and a lot of the colleges in Chennai, the interns, even from SRM, we've had a few interns who come and worked with us. So literally the whole project, we spliced it into two-month small projects. So which was literally for the last 3 years, we have survived completely with just interns working from colleges in and around various parts of India. And now we have international interns. We have two French people. So we are a multinational intern working for IIFA. So that way, then we also, interestingly, like you saw a dance performance earlier in the afternoon. Very interestingly, I came across a gentleman who was handicapped. And you opened up this whole opportunity saying, why don't you look at handicapped people, because they're very talented and they're very, they get a lot of training. And especially there's a blind school in Chennai which is doing fantastic work. They train them on call center, programming applications, Microsoft, everything, the entire application. I have a programmer who can do programming. My entire website is programmed by a blind programmer. Then I have call centers. My PA is blind. My entire call center is operated by blind people. And also we work very closely with even mentally challenged people like Banyan and Rasa. Because if you take the entire agri industry and break it down to small tasks like sorting, grading, weighing, putting it into a crate, loading it, you know, this can be done by anybody. Zero skill, you know. On one side you have IT industry coming up and saying there is a report which was published saying, oh, employability of Tamil Nadu is only 20%. That's bullshit. No, everybody is employable. It's just that you don't know how to utilize their skills. You are expecting somebody with Java 1.4. Oh, everybody who knows Java 1.3 is not employable. That is not the way to look at employability. As far as we see, even somebody who hasn't passed LKG is employable in the agri industry, and very beautifully. And so we started looking at ways, how do we engage these people? So whoever, whatever talent they have, whatever handicap they may have. So we started working with them. So it was also became an opportunity for them to start engaging with us, and also self-employment opportunity. So that's why we built the model. And slowly along the way, we also built a technology platform. So initially, we were working only in Chennai. Then we got funded. Then investors came. Then I said, why don't you make it scalable? Then now we are working on a technology platform where basically the farmers' problems have been very simple. Marketing. They want more buyers. Then they want to have suppliers. They want to contact if they want seeds and supplies. It's a very big pain to kind of find out who the best guys are. Then labor. How to contact labor. And of course, transport. So interestingly, in other industries, these problems have been solved very nicely by technology. Like for example, Bharat Matrimony. I don't know how many of you have used or aware of it, but you know, brides and grooms can nicely match each other. Okay, so that's a similar model. So a buyer and a seller put all their parameters, we match them. Then we have Red Bus, we have Fast Track. Similarly, we have a fast lorry. You know, a Meru cab's equivalent in the lorry industry, where you can book a lorry. A farmer can call somebody, a call center, a lorry comes, picks it up, and goes back and delivers. So these kind of models are there in other industries. We're trying to adapt them to the agri industry, and all of these are just in progress. So you'll see a lot more of that coming. And it was quite interesting the last few years with the kind of media attention we've got and all that has really helped. The government is also calling us. A lot of government agencies and aid agencies are closely working with us now. So we are hopeful of expanding this and making it a lot more solid. And another thing, since there are a lot of youngsters, they do come and ask me like, you know, can we start a company? Is it difficult? Should I go and take an MBA course and stuff like that? But the thing is, it's like learning cycling, okay? Because even as a Tambram, I never believed that I will ever run a business on one fine day. Sometimes I'm pushed to it. So the thing is like, you know, it is like cycling. Like you can learn a book, you can read all videos and stuff like, but at the end of the day, you have to start riding and you will fall. Even if your dad and mom are riding behind you and, you know, helping you out, someday you have to let go of them, you have to start riding on your own. So doing a business or starting a company or something like that is always like riding a cycle. So don't be afraid of the fall. Keep falling. The successful entrepreneurs are ones who have fallen more. Okay, so they've fallen more in various ways, in small cycles, big cycles, motorbikes, everything. So they're no longer afraid of the fall. And even if they fall, they know how to get up and start back on their cycles again. Some big guys, for example, the king